harder for them to switch employers once they arrive in the destination country, but also could be due to the lack of knowledge and information about these laws itself, right? As well as information about other market conditions, such as who are looking to hire them. So these incomplete information can, in effect, tie migrant workers to their current employer, right, and lead them to accept less favorable terms of employment. So in this study, we want to examine whether relaxing these information constraints, especially related to job-to-job transition, can improve employment outcomes of foreign workers. So over the past few decades, we have seen this huge rise in migration. But what's probably more surprising until very recently, that more majority of them were actually migrating for the purpose of employment. And more so, almost half of them are women, which has also brought in this whole change in terms of gender dynamics in these countries that tends to send these migrant female workers to work in countries like Singapore and Hong Kong. What is true is most of this growth in international migration has been driven by individuals migrating from developing to developed countries. Right. And it's perhaps not surprising because these kind of labor migration often leads to high income gains. And these gains are obviously shared back with their families who are left behind through remittances, and remittances, of course, have been shown to improve various kinds of socioeconomic well-being of the migrant as well as their household members who are left behind. Despite these benefits from international migration, migrant workers still face important barriers to improving their economic conditions while working abroad. One example is incomplete information in foreign labor markets, right? And when we say that, what we mean is incomplete information about wages and job vacancies that are available in the foreign labor market, as well as lack of knowledge about legal rights and regulations pertaining to their employment, right? And both of these factors could, you know, increase the search cost for these migrants and therefore reduce their reservation wage or create monopsony power for the employers, and overall generally weaken workers' bargaining power and also decrease their actual employment outcomes, right, while they were working abroad. Information imperfection is nothing new in terms of migration. They have in fact been shown to affect in some cases and not affect in the others the migration decision itself, right? But also influence migrants' remittance behavior as well as saving rates. And all of these are thought to have to undermine the economic benefits that a migrant can get from migrating abroad and working overseas. And in fact, when policymakers look at migration as a legitimate development policy, they tend to focus on, you know, increasing remittances or increasing migration earnings mostly through pre-departure training programs as a way to improve employment outcome for migrants and therefore maximize the potential from international migration. But in this work, we are actually looking at the impact of improving information related to migrant workers' job mobility after he or she migrates abroad and starts working in a destination country. And in that sense, it's very similar to the very traditional active labor market policies we tend to think about that all governments implement, right? That gives you their unemployed workers more information to help them find jobs. But most of these policies either do not specifically target migrant workers in their country, or they, in fact, in some policies, they exclude migrant workers from these programs and specifically only target native workers. So in this case, our study is also related to this small field of work that tries to understand distortions in the foreign labor market. So one paper that is pretty recent, I think it's an older citation, where in UAE, there's a kafla system where ties migrant workers to their employee. So upon completion of the contract, the migrant worker has to go back home before he or she can be rehired. So Naidu and his co-authors look at relaxing constraints on rehiring of expired contracts and finds that it improves earning, but it actually comes at the cost of new migrant workers. whose wages go down, right? And McKenzie et al. 2014 also show patterns in Philippine migration response to overseas economic shock that are consistent with migrant workers having binding minimum wages. So here, all we try to do is show empirical relevance of imperfect information in the labor market for migrant workers, right? And particularly information related to job transition. And in some sense, this is in the same favor as other papers that have looked at extensive use of easier online search options that changes the nature of the employment conditions, price as well as quantity in the market.
Are you going to address the question of whether or not the migrants have more or less information? I mean, there's a lot of imperfect information about job markets internally or externally. Talking about the networks that we've talked about before, there could be a lot of very good information, right? If there's somebody out there finding a job, getting information.
So
I'm just curious if that's part of your study.
So I'll show you a data that we're currently collecting part of the bigger study, where we tell them to place themselves in the distribution, and I'll show you how many people overestimate, underestimate along different employment distribution.
I see. Relative to the observed distribution.
Exactly. But unfortunately, in this pilot study, we can't do much. But in the current study, we're trying to also understand why some the different direction of biases as well, right? Why do some people overestimate and why some people underestimate?
Well, I'm just thinking information. Pervasive. So
it's not obvious. So like in paper, you know, the Munchie paper, you know, yeah. that you cite again in terms of the Mexican migration, you have, again, it's all about this information. It's this network that's providing information about the opportunities in the U.S.
Yeah, so we also have a migrant network map. So we do know what is the average characteristic of the network in terms of their perception of wages and employment conditions related to our respondents. So we can do some kind of correlation of how their perception is formed by the network.
So I thought you would have answered. There's a huge group in Singapore, and they get together every Sunday. So I think there's fairly, at least, some flow of information and networks there.
You would be surprised.
They email back to their home country. So.
Oh, okay. Are you worried about like what happens to the people in Singapore, or whether they come to Singapore?
Well, they come to Singapore partly because they have friends and neighbors and
sure. Okay.
So they get almost permanent. They get a job lined up.
No, but his study is about people in Singapore, whether they get information or not.
But I guess the issue is, do they actually don't have information to begin with, right? So we have a, starting from an assumption here that there is information asymmetry. And therefore, but the fact that our treatment has proved that it is
not. I understand when I interview people in Singapore, they can have perfect information.
Exactly.
Already because the job is what.
Yeah, maybe it's also looking at the formal channels which the government has established for getting information to the informal channels that they negotiate among their networks.
Yeah. But I'll show you that they actually do not have the complete information.
Okay.
But you're right that in this, through social networks, it could be that they already come with the perfect information to begin with. But if that was the case, even in our base pilot study, we shouldn't have seen any additional effect of the treatment, which is purely information. Right?
I thought you said they were getting contracts in advance, right? Or they're not.
So they come up with a contract.
Right, so the contract would give them already information. They know
only their information.
Their information.
Yes. But they don't know what other people.
But those are contracts in advance?
Yes.
Okay, fine. I'm just trying to understand the mechanism.
Yeah. So what we do here is
can you break the contract though? You work with an employer and you decide, oh, there's a better job across the street. Can you do that?
Yes, in Singapore it is. And it's unique to Singapore, especially for this type of migrant workers.
How much of that turnover is that?
Not much. So that's what we're trying to sort of look at.
Okay.
So what we actually do is basically provide factual information about labor regulations, in particular related to job transition and also how to break a contract. Right. As well as some information about labor market conditions like job vacancy for now. And what we find is providing these information improves the employment outcomes. I'll go into detail later. It improves the future intention of what they report. Are they going to bargain for better employment outcomes in the future? It also improves the knowledge of labor laws. So even when we test about the knowledge in follow-up, they still can answer the questions correctly compared to the control. We don't find, however, any effect on search behavior, right? But we do find higher intensity of search as well as actual switching of jobs among workers with poor baseline conditions to begin with. Right? And walk you through the results of the differential effects and all that as we go. So for those of you who are not familiar with foreign domestic worker labor market, it's all of them, at least in Singapore, have to be female. It's common in countries like Singapore, Hong Kong, but also in many of the Middle Eastern countries, right? So 60% of educated women with children in Hong Kong actually employs a foreign domestic worker. So it's a fairly common phenomenon in these countries.
Right? So educated
thing? This means college degree or above. And one in every five households in Singapore employs a foreign domestic worker. Most of them tends to come from developing countries in the region like Philippines, Indonesia, Sri Lanka. They also make a huge proportion of migrant workers that these countries send out, not just in terms of female migrant workers, but overall migrant workers. So in Philippines, foreign domestic workers that go abroad each year constitutes around 35% of their overall immigrants out of Philippines, both male and female combined. And same thing is true for Sri Lanka as well.
And how highly educated are these women?
So they're
relative to their employers.
So there is a law that there is a call it at least 8 years of schooling required for Singapore. But you'll see that most of them actually have a college degree.
Yeah.
But it's not clear the quality of that degree, like what it actually means in terms of the skills they have.
But they are relatively educated.
Yes. 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 And most of these hiring process here happens through these middlemen or agents. So there are around 1,000 in Singapore whose job is basically, if I am a household in Singapore, I walk into an employment agency and I tell them I want to hire a foreign domestic worker. They have a database with very few characteristics, such as just a picture. Basically, how old is she, where is she from, and where else has she worked, right? So it used to be that before, based on that, an employer would choose who she wants to hire, where the person is actually still in Philippines or in their home country. So once the contract gets signed between the agent and the household, then the agent brings her to the destination country, right? So right now, there is a more frequent use of Skype, and more through interviews, so there's a better matching, but still it's a very ad hoc process. Here you go. So at least working in Singapore, all of them need to have at least 8 years of education. The household has to pay a security bond of 5,000 as well as monthly tax of having FDW. They are provided with personal accident and medical insurance. There are a few laws that govern their employment. They cannot be paid later than 7 days after the monthly cycle.
Right.
They need to be provided at least one rest day per week. So they work 6 days a week, and they have 1 day off. And that's Sunday where we do our survey. There are these vague sort of statements that no one really knows what it means. But they should be provided safe working conditions. One thing that might be relevant to us in terms of their social network in Singapore is they do live with their employer, and they have to, right? So you'll see some of the surveys that show their freedom of movement and how easily they can leave their house at will. And you see that there's a lot of restrictions regarding that. Most of the contracts are two-year contracts, but they are renewable. There's no minimum wage or any guidelines in terms of work hours and other things. That is in Singapore, whereas if you look at another country like Hong Kong, which also tends to import a lot of foreign domestic workers, they have some benefits and rules regarding these.
It's not in the paper. The Philippines, don't they impose a $400 US
yes,
minimum wage?
Yeah.
$400 US per month.
So what Singapore law does allow them to do is they can change employer at any time before the contract ends, without having to leave Singapore, without using an employment agent, right, and without paying any fines. So this seems like obvious, but if you look at countries like Hong Kong, if you break a contract, you actually have to leave Hong Kong first and then come back again in order to rework in Hong Kong, right? And even if you look at countries like Middle East that tends to have a lot of foreign domestic workers as well as construction workers, not only they're not allowed to break the contract, but until very recently, you cannot reapply for the same job without leaving the country, right? So even if your employer is satisfied with you and your contract's ending, you have to go back and reapply through the general process again. So in terms, when it comes to job mobility compared to these countries, Singapore is much more relaxed.
So why?
So one thing that the government says is one way to regulate and ensure there is no discrimination or, you know, lower wages or some kind of... you think about extreme employment outcome as being beaten by your employer or your wages not being paid by your employer. So one way to do it is put these external laws in place that says employees cannot work more than X hours a day. But from the government standpoint, the nature of this job is so ad hoc. You work and live in the same place. Some of these traditional employment rules are not really applicable here. So they want the free market to sort of work and allow free job mobility so that the market employment conditions is more acceptable. So this
is bound by the terms, the length of the initial contract.
No, they can break the contract.
No, I said break the contract, but it does end. There is a term when they go back. You know, not just looking at the bullet.
Yeah.
So they're free to move.
Yeah.
But then the question is, there is a contract length. What happens in the contract?
So the contract is employer specific. So if I break a contract with employer A and I switch to employer B, I sign a new 2-year contract.
A new 2-year?
Yes.
Okay, that's what I was
asking. Yeah.
So I can really stay around the government.
Oh, yeah. So in fact, on average in our sample, they have been here for at least 8 years.
I see. Okay. Sure.
Suppose I'm an employer of a domestic worker, I'm not paying her, I'm beating her. And then she wants to leave, she still requires my approval there. So it's not so free.
Yes,
right?
It's not as free because you do require an approval from your current employer. So, but if you go to the arbitration board and claims these are happening, often the employers are forced to sign the contract. And from what we know, rehiring FTWs is very easy for households. So in fact, if you hire an FTW, you get 10 free replacement if you are not satisfied. So from the employer standpoint, the cost of letting go of an FTW is not that high. But you're right that this could be one of the binding constraints why we don't see mobility. And in fact, we don't. Like fewer than 3% of FTWs from the government data have changed more than 2 employers who are currently working in Singapore.
Puzzle. I had a hard time trying to reconcile those two observations.
Which
that the first one, that half again are with them for only less than a year, and then fewer than 3% have changed more than 2 employers, which seems to me to be telling me that there's a huge pool of individuals who come and work for a relatively short time, and then they leave.
Yes.
And then they leave, and
yes,
then they're done.
Yes.
But the issue is, you said on average they have stayed for 8 years.
Yeah, but it's driven by the outliers, right? So there are people who have stayed there for 20 years, 30 years. But if you look at the transient nature of the labor market, it is fairly transient too, right? So they come work in Singapore, they might go back and come back again, or they move around different countries. Like they go to Singapore for a couple of years, then go to Hong Kong and all that. So it is a very transient labor market.
So that observation about their entire kind of occupation history,
yeah,
or just about those in Singapore?
So this is at the time in Singapore.
Okay, that's
yes,
what you're saying.
That's
what.
Slash, can I ask one more like context question? So it seems like this sort of law would have like dramatically reduced the incentives of the recruitment industry to actually spend time like figuring out how to do the matching process. But you're saying that there's actually been like an increase in the use of like Skype and pre-matching screening.
Yes, but that would be true on the supply side as well, right? Because it's easier and it's relatively cost effective to do so now. They provide that. Part of it is there's fair amount of competition within the agents as well, because there's, you know, you can always switch agents. So that could partly explain why they are, you see the improvement in matching, or at least incentive to improve in matching.
Sometimes for the agents, maybe it's personal experience of a candidate 25 years ago, that if one doesn't work out, there's an obligation on their part to go ahead and try to find someone else for you.
I see.
So there are costs again in so far as that, you know, they decide to go work for somebody else.
Sure.
So if you're switching employers, do you, the employee, have any obligation to the agent who
plays
you, or do you just move on?
No, so you pay the fee upfront, and once you are matched, you are done. Your relationship with the agent is finished.
Yeah.
So the agent is only there to write the contract.
Yeah. Yeah, and so that's very different from the Indonesian and other contexts, because the Philippines actually, they have a well-functioning credit market for migrants, right? Which is for this type of migration, which is very unique in a lot of ways and makes it possible, you know, they're not in debt contracts in the way
that... So in countries like Hong Kong also, not just from the sending point, but the receiving countries like Hong Kong, having any debt with your agent illegal, that is also true in Singapore, right? So you're not supposed to have any existing debt with your agent that ties you to the agent even after you break the contract.
So suppose, as you were saying, in case there is a problem, you can't leave the employer because, you know, there are certain conditions, and you have to actually go to the arbitration center.
Yes.
So this can be both sides, right? I mean, the problems can be on either side. So does the agent play any role in any of these things then?
So they might, but it's only anecdotally, like that I we know, that the agent has an incentive to make the matching work.
I mean, the agent is not responsible for getting the information about the worker as such, collecting information before the contract signing.
Can you repeat that again?
I said the agent doesn't have any role to have a responsibility of knowing the worker and the employer before getting this contract signed, even if you're paying for that.
Yes, I mean, agent would prefer to have a good match, right? And have a good employee who they think is going to stay with the employer. Because if that doesn't work out, it's on the agent to find a new FTW for free to their housing.
Oh, okay.
That
is
important.
Oh, too.
Yeah.
Right.
Okay. All right, so just briefly going to what we did, it was very ad hoc again. We went to this mall in Singapore where we know all the Filipino FTWs on Sundays go hang out. We went, sent students who were trained and asked them to recruit people to participate in our study. We got around 303 FTWs. Again, it's a very small sample. Our respondent rate was around 33%. So clearly it's not a representative sample, and I'll show you how Filipino, our sample, differs from other samples that people have collected from Singapore. And what we did was, at the spot, we administered a baseline survey, and then we divided them into either treatment or control. The treatment FTWs received treatment soon after, right on the spot. And all of them were contacted between 7 to 8 months after the baseline.
Do they know each other at all?
No. They could. So we don't know. Yeah. So there might be an information spillover.
Yeah.
We made sure that each time you approach someone, you don't interview the same person from the group. But it could be over time, you know, you have these contamination. But that would only bias our effect towards zero.
Right. And how successful were you in the follow-ups? So what percentage?
I'll show you. Yeah. It was bad, but not as bad as, you know, what other people have done.
So what percentage of all the migrants in the Philippines are Filipino?
They are the majority. Yes, so they are the majority. So around 3/4 are Filipino FTWs. Right, so there was a question on college graduates. So in fact, around 60% do have a college graduate degree. On average, they have been working with the same employer for 4 years. What was a little surprising is if you look at the minimum wage law, so these are all Filipino migrants who are bounded by Philippine government minimum wage requirement, which is $400. And we find that, at least in our sample, around 30% report that they actually make less than $400 per month. If you look at, so we tested them on various knowledge, right?
But that's a difficult concept in some sense. Because you're living in a home, so you're getting consumption benefits and housing over there. So you want like a real income measure. So I could pay them nothing and then give them splendid living.
But that would be a use.
So the minimum wage is in cash? Is it terms of cash?
Yes, it's in cash.
So the minimum wage is in cash.
Even in time, is all I'm saying. I don't know.
Yeah, so there could be a trade-off.
For a living.
Yeah.
Oh, that's a margin. Yeah.
So in fact, in our this study, we find that people value these other benefits more than cash. Right? So there could be definitely a trade-off between salary and other benefits.
Correct.
Yeah. Like separate living room.
Do you have any kind of notion of what the amenities are in the home?
Or
the place of work?
So, in this data we don't, but in the new data we do measure the freedom of movement, how easily they can move around and move outside, whether they have a separate room versus they share a room with someone, and how often does the employer search their room without their consent and all these other things.
Yeah, it's just less distressing. Maybe, you know, they're paying other forms, so actually they're doing other.
Yeah, and they rate, like, it could be as simple as quality of the meal as well, right? Which we do find that they value more. So we do measure it in the main study.
One thing I was going to ask my comments, I'd like to know the variation, because my guess is there's not that much variation in wages compared to working conditions. Is that?
I'm showing the variation, actually, at the very end. Because using this data and the other data, we created the distribution, which happened to be the information intervention in the next round. So it goes from as high to around $800 to $1,000 to as low as $400 to $300.
And what's your restricted sample here?
So this is attrition. So I'll talk about attrition now.
Okay.
So we lose 40% of our people by 7 months' time. What it is high, but it's not higher than what other studies that have looked at a transient workforce have found. In fact, it's fairly similar to Emmer et al. And Arshav et al. They look at El Salvador migrants in BC that also has a high transient nature. What is true is the attrition rate is not different between our control and treatment group, as well as the seems to be balanced in our characteristics across both the full sample and the restricted sample.
How do you follow them up?
We call them. Now we track them by WhatsApp and a few other things. Because they live in the household, they have Wi-Fi access to the of the household. So, but here we basically call them after 7 months.
So is there any information you can get from employers whose employees have left?
So in this one, we did not contact the employer. In this coming study, we are intending to also interview the employer, as long as we get approval from the IRB, which is still iffy right now, because the employee volunteered for the study, so we can't really as easily go to the employer and say, break the confidentiality with the employee. So in terms of how representative our sample is compared to the FTW population in Singapore, unfortunately, there's no census data publicly available, provided by the Singapore government. The only one that we know of in terms of FTW characteristics is another basic survey administered by a research unit in Singapore, which is obviously also not representative. But what is true is they go to multiple locations across Singapore, and they have FTWs of different nationalities. Unlike us, we only have Filipinos. So what we can at least do is to show you how Filipinos are different from the rest of the FTWs who work in Singapore, and also compare characteristics among Filipinos across these two samples. If you look at it, clearly Filipinos are a little more older, they're slightly more educated, but they're also more experienced in terms of working longer in Singapore than other FTWs. But despite that, in terms of labor mobility, they're as restricted as other FTWs.
So I think, if anything, the restrictiveness of your sample should work against finding like any effects of information, right? I mean, it should just bias you downward, given that the ones who aren't able to leave their home on Sunday to join their, you know, their fellow country people and take a day off, right?
So if you think about, we are getting the cream of the crop here.
Yeah.
For them, the incentive to respond is not as high, right? The benefit of responding, because they already have good employment conditions.
Right. I guess, okay, so maybe I guess I'm thinking more about like the people that show up to this mall.
Yeah.
Right? I mean, their information could be much less important for them than it could be for the people who can.
Yeah, no, I agree. So if you already have information, therefore you are able to come to the mall, yeah, it's less relevant for them. Also, they are self-selecting to participate, right? Which goes the other way, which is,
right,
I'm self-selecting to be part of the study, yeah, so I'm more willing to respond to it as well. So it's not clear which direction the bias would go here. So a couple of you asked about, okay, what are the other conditions they might value? So this is from the home sample. They ask the employee, does employer let you leave the house at will? In fact, only around 30% of them say that they can leave the house when they are not working at will. And there seems to be a lot of restrictions. Also, searching FTW belongings without their consent. At least 20% of them report that their employers walk into their room and search. But more importantly, so there are slight differences between Filipinos and others, but between the Filipinos of our sample and their sample, there doesn't seem to be much difference, except for, you know, more than 8 hours minimum wage. But when you do, whether these characteristics are jointly different, they are not.
So why does their sample include so few Filipinos?
So the third of their, the one I give you the breakdown comes from a government issued report a while ago. Whereas their weights of what fraction they want to survey is different for some reason.
They might have just gotten different malls. You know, like, if you go to Golden Mile, you're going to
They had a guideline in terms of sampling, and they decided to interview Indonesians more than Filipinos.
You mean they did?
Yeah, they did.
Oh, okay, that's the answer.
Yeah, exactly.
They selected.
But I don't know why they chose a different way than what we found from the government report. Let me briefly tell you the data that we currently are collecting. So we are, so far we have 1,300 FTWs in the baseline being interviewed from different places. And what we do is, among these other things, we measure in more detail their knowledge of law as well as their knowledge of wages and other employment conditions. So if you look at these first 5 laws, what has related to job mobility, there's fair amount of variation in terms of knowledge across these laws. But what is true is they get around on average 3 out of the 5 questions correctly, right? And if you look, and these 4 are other laws related to their employment conditions in general, which they do a little bit better, right? But only around 12% of them actually can correctly answer all 5 of these labor mobility laws, and 5% of them can correctly answer all 10 of these.
Do you know their language ability, or whether they can?
So we have different languages. Indonesians are asked in their own language. Filipinos ask in English for this one.
So you have non-Filipinos in this new study?
In the new study, yes. But what's more interesting is what we don't have from before is the information about distribution, right? So we asked them, okay, can you estimate what a typical FTW makes in Singapore? Very crudely, but we tell them, someone like you, so when we see whether they match or not, we look at their characteristic FTWs based on nationality and years of experience. So only 60% of them cannot correctly estimate what typical FTW like them have.
By what margin?
Yes.
Yeah.
Oh, what?
No, this is between, so we have a range, but I don't know how,
yeah, right.
I mean, whether like it's $1 to the right or $100 to the left. But it's not that I have to say $500 precisely. As long as I say between $450 and $500. So we ask them to choose the...
A major thing just to show intervals.
Yes, so that's how we ask, exactly. And
even this question, show it.
Yes. Yes, exactly. And in fact, it's not just everyone's overestimating. So basically, majority of them in terms of wage are overestimating the number of people they think they are earning more than them, right? So they are putting themselves in a lower distribution than where they are when it comes to wage. 13% of them don't know it at all where they fall in the distribution. But when it comes to work hours, the information is as incomplete. 73% cannot correctly pick a bin where the median work hours is. When it comes to whether they overestimate or underestimate, they are equally likely to overestimate and equally likely to underestimate, 33% versus 42%. Let me.
On an earlier slide, you had something about working more than 8 hours and 97% work more than 8 hours. What is the median work?
So, again, so in that study we asked how many hours you typically work, but it's hard for them to sort of separate out their work hours from rest hours because they work in the same place they do it. But in the new study we asked them task by task, typically taking care of cleaning, so we add them up. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I do need to hurry up, I think I'm down. So our intervention is very crude. We combine all this for the pilot study where we give them flyers and someone sits down and walks them through what are the laws, how to request for transfer, where to go, where to submit the forms and all that. We also give them access to online job website, which is free, saying that they can go and look for jobs. Each week we print out the latest 10 postings, which is updated weekly, and give them so they can call. I'm going to just show you the results quickly now. So in terms of the effect on the knowledge, right? So this is 7 months after they were given. So we find positive impacts on their knowledge. So they do remember the laws that they were told for the treatment, especially the first two. The knowledge index is basically the average of the four. So in this case, it's the share of questions you got in the class. When it comes to employment outcome, we see improvement in work hours. So they decline work hours. And they claim that besides salary and work hours, the other employment conditions improve. We don't see much on salary as well as switching employers by 6 months, 7 months time. But if you create an employment index, we see a slight increase in the employment outcome measured by the index. But if you take these two results together, their work hours are declining without decreasing their salary, so their effective hourly wage is going up. It's just basically the average of the four variables.
So do you interpret this as a going to their employer and saying, I want better hours and conditions, otherwise I know I didn't have to leave?
Yes. Right. But you'll see that among those who already had a bad match, they actually improve by switching. In terms of intentions, is the same. So we see improved intention of asking for better work hours and rest days in the future, but not so much on salary or job search. And we don't see much on actual search within that 6 months period after the treatment was administered. What I'm going to do is show you a differential effect.
So you didn't ask, did you discuss with your employer?
We did not.
So you show me something which entitles me to less hours and come back to less hours. You say, do you get less hours?
And I say, oh yeah. Oh no, so we ask them, what is their hours?
I want to look as our gun.
So we ask how much hour you work in the follow-up. Unless they are lying.
Well, I'm wondering whether I want to give you an answer, but it makes me look as I responded to you.
It's worried about honor, in fact.
That's all. Yeah. I'm a nice, polite person. I don't want to tell you you're wasting your time.
So this is compared to the baseline, right? So basically, if the treatment person feels that, oh, I was given the treatment, now he's asking for hours again, I might better say low. That's yes. There could be a bias here. But we don't see that in salary, but in other dimensions. So if you think that people are lying in general, you might think that they might be lying, especially on, you know, changing employers.
It's not lying.
I wouldn't use lying.
It's cramming, yeah.
It's cramming, yeah. He was telling me. I think he's now a different
one. Well, maybe there's some collective response as well, because of, I mean, you're going to a place where they're collating together, right? So, I mean, there would be an understanding among all of them to give a certain kind of response to your questions. Is that possible?
Could be, as long as all the treatment people are meeting.
As you're saying, the wages are not saying so much of difference. Yeah. But there would be a collective understanding of these people who feel that they're not going to disclose a higher wage. Mm-hmm. To the, it's just possible.
Yeah, it is. This is purely self-reported.
So is it possible that the workers did not argue for bargaining with their employer, but they just shook?
So for that we need to get the employer's side, which we are doing now. I'm gonna hold on the questions and quickly go through some of the basic results. First thing we do is try to see whether knowledge improvement in knowledge is the operative channel. One way to sort of truly do it is see whether all the effect is concentrated among people who had low knowledge to begin with, right? And we see that, I guess I'm gonna skip the knowledge bit, in terms of employment, all the positive effects from the treatment are coming from people who are initially low knowledge. And mind you, the sample here is very small, so when you subdivide it, it's going to get even smaller. But at least the direction of the results are a priori what we would have expected. The interaction term here is all negative. And if you look at the effect of the treatment on those who had already a good level of knowledge in the baseline, you don't see any effect of the treatment. But the difference between the two groups are only significant on the employment index. Same thing is also true when you look at intention outcomes in terms of heterogeneity. But what we thought would be interesting is at least try to look at, given the fact that those who have lower employment outcomes to begin with, they should have the greatest incentive to respond to our treatment. And in the other, also policy-wise, they are the ones where your intervention one to be targeting towards. So we look at differentially people who have poor baseline conditions and the effect of the treatment. And what we find is, in fact, the positive effect of the treatment is coming from individuals who have low baseline to begin with, which is the sum of the two. In fact, among that group, you find that it increases their propensity to actually switch within 6 months of getting that information, right? So the sum is significant marginally at the 10% level, and which we didn't see early on our average treatment effect, right? So in effect, there was a question on how is this improvement in employment outcome coming from? At least among the vulnerable FPWs, it's coming from actually switching. Right, and improving their outcome.
You know that. I mean, did you look at the ones who didn't switch and see what happened to them?
We did, but we can do that. Yes. The last one is when we do the same thing for intention, it's the other way down. Among the non-vulnerables, they report intending to bargain for better wages and work conditions in the future. Whereas among the vulnerables, the treatment effect is nil. Right? So intuitively, what might be explaining this is the difference in timing of responding to the treatment based on whether you are vulnerable to begin with or not. Right? So if you are a low baseline to begin with, I immediately act on the treatment and change employer and improve my outcome. Whereas among those who have a good match in the baseline, they don't improve their outcome or switch, but they report that in the future, they're going to ask for better wages. Right? Okay, I'm really late, so I'm gonna stop here.
Thank you for inviting me. This is a great conference to be in. The fact that we're colleagues, is there some mistake on the first
yes.
page? Yes. Oh, how do you spell his name?
Why?
Oh, who cares? No, sorry.
Did you get your name?
Yeah. Yes. Well, you see, Dean's name is not in the catalog. So anyways, moving right along. Slesh is my colleague. He's part of this group of very good young Applied Micro people we've been able to hire at NUS. Where's the clicker? Thanks. Is he the real Dean? Pardon me?
Dean.
Hi.
How does this work?
Yeah.
Oh, good. Okay. Anyways, very nice paper. I should say in terms of first full disclosure, I only had access to the early results, and they weren't exactly sold as a pilot. But anyway, so somewhat. But I think some of my comments will have relevance to the second data collection. In terms of Jerry's question, obviously this kind of arrangement of, you know, helps families in Singapore and Hong Kong, but as Slesh pointed out, it's incredibly important for the families in the Philippines through remittances. And, you know, many of these domestic workers are married. In the paper, I guess you were not allowed to ask if they had kids, but it seems like at least anecdotal evidence says a lot of them do have kids, whether they're married or not. And as Slesh said, there is considerable evidence that families in the Philippines are better off because of the remittances. Now, in terms of general implications, what I liked about it is at least my limited knowledge of these information interventions.
But they're not bringing their children.
So yeah,
they're left behind children in the Philippines.
Okay, first of all, they're voting with their feet, which is Chicago I should like. But secondly, they are sending a lot of money home. The amount of money home they're sending, and it is kind of extended family, right? It's like grandparents taking care of the kids. So you're right. It's not,
well, I do find some pretty negative effects.
In the Philippines?
No, no, no. Or China.
Okay. I see. And do their remittances, they send a lot of remittances back, but they're still worse off.
But the remittances you send from a Chinese city back to the village are not so big as the remittances.
These are huge.
If you think about parental care and grandparent care, the difference will be huge.
Let's say this is an open question. This is Slesh's problem, not my problem. But I think the size of the remittances, as Juan pointed out, is different. So there's costs and benefits, of course. But so it's very important to find out whether these families are better off. We'll change it that way.
Is that known anywhere, the net effect? I mean, just estimating the supply response. I mean, that's true in Mexico. It's true, right, in China, now in the Philippines. I'm just curious, empirically.
I think the Philippines remittances are probably the highest. So I think, but it obviously.
What proportion of their income they're sending home?
I thought 20% of GDP is remittances. I don't know how. Do you know how much they're sending home?
In fact, most of them do not see it in Philippines, and there's no other expenses because they live and eat in the house. So majority of the income they earn goes back. But then the question is, who do they send it back to? That determines the welfare.
I'm not going to run out of time. Obviously, a very important question is whether they're better off. I'll try and yell louder than Jim.
But the differences in the families from which the Filipinos are migrating from are very different than what's coming out of the Chinese countryside. A high percentage of these are educated. You know, they have university, college, degrees.
These guys, yeah.
That's separate.
Yeah.
So we're just, you know, so even if they're kids, again, in some sense, are being reared again by one of the spouses.
Yeah.
We're talking about very different kinds of
things. I think you're just showing the importance of this new research on the Filipino families, but I'm moving on.
Okay. Wait, but then the opportunity cost is enormous.
No, that's not wages in the Philippines. Anyway, let's move back to Singapore. One thing, very nice place. This is kind of mushy, but actually, it is important for Singapore how they treat these people because, you know, as a typical economist, before I moved there, I thought, well, they vote with their feet. But I think a country you treat like foreign workers as objects is just not good for the country. And I won't say any more. But it did strike me. In terms of an experiment, there's an excellent choice of group. In the sense that it's going to work here. Everybody speaks English, they're highly educated, and you can't bribe your way. If you actually are violating things, you certainly cannot bribe your way out at, let's say, the arbitration hearing. So if it doesn't work here, it's going to be hard to know where it will work. Now, in two directions, the basic econometrics, including expanding the data that they're doing in the second proposal, I also would suggest refocusing the sampling frame to focus on the vulnerable, because if you have people who are in a pretty good situation, it's hard to see how your intervention affects them. Are they going to move to super good? And so that would probably be my biggest comment. And also do more of the data you have. It sounds like you're doing that but with the combined data. So so the econometric, this is, as Slesh put out, the equation of interest. I'll focus on the vulnerable because I think they're the most interesting. They're about a quarter of the sample instead of about 13%. And so this is the equation of interest. And okay, so we said vulnerable. And so we're interested really in two coefficients. Do I want this? Oh yeah, alpha 1 is just a treatment effect for everybody, or if you're not vulnerable. And then of course alpha 1 plus alpha 2 is a treatment effect for the vulnerable. One thing you do is you give it a p-value for that, but you don't give the coefficient, right? And that's probably the more interesting parameter in the paper. Now, you know, there is this small sample issue. You get, the sample's about 187. The vulnerable group's about 25%. So it means you have 24 vulnerable workers in the treatment group. So my argument is we're kind of in finite sample econometrics. And power's clearly an issue. You know, the zero coefficients have big confidence intervals, which just, you know, motivates how wise it is to do more and not tell your discussant. And also I think there is this backlash, and I don't fully understand it, of, you know, small randomized trials, yet how successful are we at replicating them? So I think, again, going for a big sample is, and I think the nice thing is you have very provocative, and I would argue important results here, because one thing that's nice is not just their information goes up, in a sense, who cares, but the outcomes, actually, the labor market outcomes actually change. So I think that's the thing that really gives me hope about this intervention. Now, one econometric issue, you see a million regressions like this. And, you know, the problem is P's endogenous. I mean, basically, these are probably the less assertive, maybe less educated people. And so the question is, if I put V and T times V, do all the biases cancel out? And some people argue yes, but I don't know if I've ever seen that formally. I don't know. Okay, you should.
There is, but the randomization is given. I'm not quite sure what you're saying. It's random with respect to V, I guess.
I mean, this is an endogenous variable, right?
Yeah.
This is an endogenous variable. And so the question is, if I want to estimate alpha 2, my coefficient of interest is alpha 1 plus alpha 2. And so does the endogeneity corrupt the estimate of alpha 2? And you don't see that?
Well, no, I guess what I'm thinking is the randomization per se is independent.
Sure. So no, I get alpha 1 is fine,
right?
The question is whether alpha 2 is fine.
And because the endogeneity
is
of
V.
But that would be the endogeneity of V, but the point is V itself with respect to T. You want the T-V interaction, right?
Yes.
Whether or not T-V is correlated with V.
Okay, so, but yeah, but I want to, the question is, V is correlated with E, so is T-V correlated with V? And I think it has to be. I think it has to be. But anyways, let's do this after.
E is. I mean.
Honestly. Sure, of course it does, but what my argument was, this is whether you're treated well. So I think it's going to be things like assertiveness, ability to choose an employer, maybe education. And so the question is this an outcome, right? Do you have bad working conditions? And are the people
like a bunch of straight, right? So I have a set of straight and not. Anyway, it's kind of a point.
But it's endogenous strain.
Well, that's what I'm not sure with. Why is it endogenous with respect to this E? I don't know E.
Okay. Let's argue about that. I think you can make a case, but let's argue.
I can see you might get something like that if E depends as a direct function of V.
Why is like outcomes and V are people with bad outcomes? Oh, I have 1 minute. Holy cow.
Anyways.
Let's see.
I'm
Yeah, I think this would be good over coffee or drink. One thing I would do, yeah, there is, you know, in all these tables, column 5, you do the equivalent of kind of multiple hypothesis testing, but I think the column 1 and 4, you might want to do something formally. This is old-fashioned. I would use probits in table 5 and 6 because the mean of the dependent variable 0, 1 is less than 0.1, and so there is this idea that linear probability models don't work so well right at the boundaries. So additional results, you have wages and hours, right? Not in this one? Okay. So you don't. So anyways, with the new data, I'd like to see, you know, histograms for wages, working conditions, because I suspect there's more variation in working conditions than in wages. It's much harder to monitor them. I would like to know, okay, this gets at Jim's point, how do the vulnerable workers line up versus the other ones in education? It'd be interesting to run wage equations in the new data, and especially, you know, 10 years a little tricky, but interesting. Now, table 4, the outcomes, I'm not sure, are so great. It's a dummy variable if work hours did not increase. So if they didn't increase, that's considered a good effect, right? This, I think this is in the footnote to table 4. And the other thing, same for working conditions. So at least I'd like to see, did they get better? Okay, so I think that's non-trivial. And okay, yeah, and once in your new study, when you do know hours and you do new wages, then that'd be the obvious outcome, right? As opposed to, like, before and after, did things get better? If you know them, you might as well use them. Okay, and this is my last. This gets back to one point. I'm not convinced the sample at Lucky Plaza could go either way, because, as was mentioned, the people who can't even get out of their house someday won't be there, but there's lots of other reasons not to show up. If you have a boyfriend, that people take classes. So it's not just the people who can't get out of the house Sunday morning. And I think you could get some information if you ask people if they had friends who weren't there and why aren't they there. So, yeah, overall, there's an off-the-wall comment I'll say. People like Chris Flynn have used monopsony models for the minimum wage. And I'm not sure what to make of it, but something like this kind of data might let you estimate the model. And I don't know which data would otherwise. So finally, I think it's very interesting and informative. And I'm glad you're expanding the sample. And I'd ask, you know, just ask to consider focusing on the vulnerable. Thanks.
So maybe just one question, and then let's start by continuing the discussion over the break.
So, I'm really worried about this spillover thing now that I know you sampled them in a mall, because I've been to Hong Kong malls, and you see these are very closely in groups, and how many of they sample. Even though they're not sitting together in a one group, the close group will have information interaction.
No, you're right, but I think the why we do it, it's much more spread out. It's like 4 by 4, but it's right. So there might be contamination here, but if anything, the contamination would bias the results towards 0, right? Especially if the treatment people are passing it.
But
I think what we are interested in is, in fact, to measure spillovers. So in the new study, we actually map the networks and try to map the spillovers. Because that by itself is pretty interesting.
You talked a lot about the impact on those who are vulnerable, but I would also think there would be scope for a larger impact on those who have a higher marginal utility of income, particularly who are supporting a large family, who have children at kind of crucial moments of development. So have you or will you explore that at all?
This one is just for our own sake, what we found. But yes, so that's right. So we haven't looked at that or have thought about that, but yes, we could look at people who have a higher marginal returns from income. So those are the ones who are most likely to respond. So we can definitely look at that by using proxies like children and all. I think that's what John was suggesting as well.
So do you suggest any spillovers? So that on the margins you have this group that may be moving, maybe lobbying for better working conditions, any reason to believe then that the effect just won't be limited to them, but rather may spill over to the way or to the job?
Yeah, so our sample is so small here. There's not likely to be any general equilibrium effects. Unless you think that the location where they hang out, there's some kind of congregation of employers as well that tends to come from the same area, which might create general equilibrium effects here. But I don't think so, given our small sample.
Even if you could go ahead and sample employer, even if it wasn't as part of a matched pair, you could still take a look in terms of things like separation and how that may affect how the kinds of working conditions they just have in general.
Yes, so if you can catch the employers that tends to sort of overlap with our sample, then yes, we should do that. Yeah.